They were back on television fretting about the Russian takeover of America.
What do the Russians have politically, financially, personally on Donald Trump that he fawns over Putin? The American people have a right to know.
I do not want to see our democracy undermined by having the President of the United States colluding and his officials colluding with Russia.
This love of Putin that this president is showing, and this defense of Putin that this president has done, and all of the other things that I've just alluded to, is unseemly.
We can also say that Donald Trump Jr., what he did was a threat to our democracy and borderline treason.
Borderline treason. Well, Max Blumenthal is an author, a journalist, and a lifelong man of the left. Yet he's become skeptical of the Russian collusion narrative, which he has called destructive and dangerous. Last month, Blumenthal took a camera to an anti-Russia protest on the National Mall here in Washington to find out what the people who were there actually knew about the topic. Here's part of the conversation, an amazing conversation he had with progressive Maryland Congressman Jamie Raskin.
But you said that Roger Stone hosted a show on RT.
Roger Stone hosted a series on the Russia propaganda network.
Do you believe that we need
Roger Stone didn't host a show on RT?
You think he's never been on an RT?
But he didn't host a show.
Okay, but look, you know, you can go after over any picayune details you want, but I don't see why it would be in your interest to support an autocratic authoritarian government which is jailing journalists and fighting against freedom around the world.
I think we should tell the people the truth.
Max Blumenthal joins us in studio. I love that exchange because it's similar to so many I've had on this show, where if you call into question a fact being asserted, you're immediately accused of being a handmaiden to Vladimir Putin. So let me just ask the broadest possible question. You're not a Trump voter or supporter. You're a lifelong man of the left, I think it's fair to say, pretty well-known one. And yet you don't think that this Russia story is helpful to the left or makes sense. Why?
Yeah, I mean, we have to talk about the issue of efficacy also, in addition to the fact that I haven't seen any concrete evidence and Rachel Maddow's dots may never connect. And so, you know, as someone on the left who's actually gone out and protested Trump, I didn't expect this hysteria to completely take over, but now I see what the point is of it. I see Trump as the apotheosis of a failed political establishment, both from the Democrats and the Republicans, pushing corporate trade, pushing permanent war, and I thought the Democrats should have responded with a big narrative against permanent war and for economic equality. Instead, they're pushing Russia scandal mongering nonstop. It subsumed all of the progressive grassroots movements I believed in. And it's basically buried the left in a militaristic narrative that ambitious figures like Jamie Raskin are advancing. Mark my words, Tucker, when Trump is gone, this narrative, this Russia hysteria, will be repurposed by the political establishment to attack the left and anyone on the left. Bernie Sanders-like politician who steps out of line on the issues of permanent war or corporate free trade, things like that, will be painted as Russia puppets. So this is very dangerous, and people who are progressive, who are falling into it, need to know what the long-term consequences of this cynical narrative are.
It seems virtually everyone on the left in Washington, with some exceptions, you're one, I know a couple others, but I know people who I think of as reasonable, I don't agree with them, but who seem to really believe that Vladimir Putin was in control of the last election. Do you think they believe it?
I don't know. I think there's, I can't speak for other people. I'm not a mind reader, but there's definitely a political class in Washington that sees Russia scandal mongering as a silver bullet to take out Trump. And then you have the Democrats, who are basically the Democratic establishment that came in and took out Keith Ellison, the corporate sellout establishment that can't agree on a big economic message,
right,
that doesn't favor single payer. So this is just convenient because this gives them a way of opposing Trump without having to do anything remotely progressive.
It's a little bit surprising from a perspective of someone in the media to see big news organizations full of smart people who I thought were pretty skeptical in a good way refuse to ask any of the basic questions, and instead, when you press them, say, well, some number of intelligence agencies said so. I haven't seen the evidence, but I believe them. When did that change? What is that about?
Yeah, I mean, you see a bootlicking press and a bootlicking kind of liberal opposition that believes all intelligence agencies and doesn't ask questions from these anonymous officials. I mean, you'll see on CNN a segment, U.S. officials say Russian spying is ramping up. I don't know, are Russian spies taking Adderall now? But there's never any clear sourcing never any sources on the record, and then we see stories retracted, like that the Russians hacked into our national electricity grid. Then the Washington Post said it was Burlington, Vermont's electricity grid. Then they retracted the story. So it's very hard to keep track of it, but what they've done with this scandal mongering, in addition to kind of pushing away a progressive narrative, is create the sense among a lot of people who don't have time to pay attention that there is Russian collusion, that we were attacked by Russia, and that we actually have to respond, if not with expanded sanctions, which I think is very dangerous and harms average people, but with a military response. We just saw Paul Begala on CNN calling for blowing up the Russian intelligence.
And you've seen members of Congress call this an act of war. Finally, you're a pretty, not just a member of the left, but pretty fairly well known. What kind of response have you received after saying things like this in public?
Well, I'll probably get called a Putin puppet after this show. I mean, that's pretty much all they can say. But I'd like to have a debate about the evidence. I would like to talk about the evidence behind this. But I also want to talk about whether it's a good idea to support Democrats like Ben Cardin, who are saying that this is a political Pearl Harbor and we should respond. Whether it's a good idea to expand NATO into little countries like Montenegro. Whether it's a good idea
exactly.
to be funding jihadist proxies in Syria to hurt Russia. Thomas Friedman in the New York Times called for supporting territorial ISIS in Syria to hurt Russia and Iran. And that's where this narrative is leading. It seems to be, from a purely progressive anti-war, anti-imperial position, a disastrous narrative that will have long-term consequences for the left in this country.
And there's no debate. So my son will be required to give his life to defend the territorial integrity of Montenegro?
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, maybe that's a good idea. Maybe we should debate it, but we're not.
Yeah.
Max Blumenthal, that was super interesting. Thanks for coming on.
Thanks for having me
Appreciate
on.
It.